As far as introductions go, I don't think I could have possibly asked for a better one. Feel extremely undeserving after that right now. So what I'd like to start off with is just to say how honored I am that I've been asked to come here and speak to all of you, especially looking at the lineup of people who are going to come and speak after me. Because really, if you think about talking about being deserving, I really don't deserve to stand on the same stage as all of them. But then again, I'm very happy and very thankful actually to be able to come here and talk about an issue which is very close to me. It's something which I have thought about pretty often, and I'd love to get your views on the matter. This is not going to be a lecture, a seminar, a talk, nothing like that. It's basically just a bunch of observations which I've made in my day-to-day life. And while I'm speaking, I'd like you to tally it with any observation which you might have made. And at the end of the next 10 to 15 minutes, let's see where we all are. The title of what I'm going to say is Between Black and White, and that quite obviously is the grey area, so to speak. And mainly what we're going to do here, the crux of this talk, is going to be focusing on conceptions. These preconceived notions and our opinions and where actually they come from. And obviously our only exposure, for most of us, our only exposure to the outside world, like outside that safe little bubble of our own lives, is media, right? Like in the morning we have our morning newspaper, at night we come and we hear overzealous moderators, using that term very lightly, moderating debates where they are lambasting politicians and basically shouting, and at the end of it you don't really get a true idea of what's going on. You get this sense of vilification and vindication that, you know, we all hate politicians, right? Every single problem that our country has, we immediately assign that to the government, to politicians. So when we see that somebody is actually standing there on TV and basically insulting them, accusing them, shouting at them, it's basically a position where we all want to be. But the end result is we don't get a true idea or a true picture of what's going on. And even if the moderator was moderate in that debate, I don't really think it would help, because these people, these politicians would come, they would say what they're supposed to say, they'd toe the party line. And at the end of it, you wouldn't really come out getting any more enriched than you were going in. So how do you get to the truth? How do you get to something closer to the truth? You listen to both sides, you think, you imagine, you analyze, you get into the matter. And only when that happens are you actually successful or able to get a true idea of what's going on. Now, we talk about irresponsible journalism. We talk about the media not being as responsible as it should be. But let's face it, none of us want pure, unadulterated news. We don't want something bland on TV or something very, very black and white on our papers. We want spice. We want entertainment. We want to be given something that is slightly out of the ordinary. And we want that. And these media houses, in spite of having a responsibility to every one of us, these media houses are businesses in their own rights. They cater to a particular brand of consumers. They have, and these consumers have demands, and if these consumers are demanding entertainment, that is what these media houses will provide. And then again, we come to the concept of, you know, all these media houses owing their allegiance to political party A and corporate house B. So at the end of it, we don't really get the truth. And what we have our opinions, right? Now, where do these opinions come from? A key matter of what we're going to talk about is awareness, right? Now, some people might say, yes, as a nation, we are very aware of what's going on. Another section will say, no, we are completely clueless about what's going on. We are very happy to be misguided and led in whatever direction these politicians and these honchos lead us. Now, again, the truth is not black, it's not white. It lies somewhere in the middle. It lies in the gray zones. What I believe, and this is my first observation for the day, is that most people know just enough about every situation to have an opinion. Putting it even more simply, man has a big ego, right? When somebody comes up to you and says, okay, what do you think about the food security bill? You wouldn't like to say, you know, I don't really know what the food security bill is all about. So you are going to be reading the papers, you're going to get some idea, some vague notion of what the food security bill is, and you're going to get the general perception of what people around you are saying about it, and you're going to form your opinion and you're going to keep it there. So when somebody asks you, you have a ready answer, but when you're asked to actually defend that idea, when you're asked to argue that idea, when you're asked to think about the other side of that topic, you won't really have anything to say, you'll draw a blank. So what to do about it? And there are many examples which I could give right now. I mean, the prevalent debate in the country right now is Narendra Modi versus Rahul Gandhi. Correct. So let's talk about Narendra Modi right now. Here's a guy, and his worst detractors basically say that he's a communal guy, and if and when he comes to power, it will be in the worst interests of some sections of society, right? This is what some people say, and then he has his supporters who say that, look at what he's done with the Gujarat model, great guy. Take it for granted that he is a communal person. Let's say he did have communal tendencies and he was involved in that Gujarat riot. Now he comes to power. He is in the national glare, the national spotlight. Every move he takes, every word he says is immediately amplified and the entire nation gets to hear about it. If I was Narendra Modi, I would have a much greater incentive to show people that I am definitely not communal. I'm anything but communal. I'm the most secular individual God ever put on the earth. Because the minute I do something contrary to that, I will immediately be vindicated on the national scale and people are going to get me out of power. So I have a greater incentive to be secular. So these allegations are not necessarily a bad thing. And the fact that he might have been communal is not really bad for the best interests of the nation. Now this is again my opinion. You might have another opinion of your own. Debate in its truest form is an expression of opinion. And there are two kinds of arguments, right? There is one argument which is constructive and the other argument which basically makes no sense whatsoever. If you're being stubborn, if you're being obstinate about your chosen side, I'm not going to entertain any other side, that doesn't lead you anywhere. But on the other hand, if you can actually get into the shoes of the person who is debating with you, who's arguing with you, and you can see where they are coming from, what is their mindset, why are they thinking the way they are thinking, you will end up with a lot more facets in your analysis of that topic. You'll be enriched. Now, we don't get to read a lot, right? How do you enlighten yourself? You read. In our day-to-day lives, the rat race and everything, if you fall a little behind, you're lost. So we don't really get time to read. What avenues do we have open for us? But even though we don't have books around us, we will always have people around us. And people will have their own respective views on a wide variety of topics. If you don't talk to them, if you don't interact with them, and interact with them about matters like this, you will not ever get a true picture of what's going on. Let's talk about Rahul Gandhi right now. A couple of days back, Rahul Gandhi walks into the press club and he basically talks about this ordinance which protects convicted legislators, and he basically calls it rubbish, garbage, something like that, going completely against the party line. Now, we have one section of society saying, wow, Rahul Gandhi is such an honest, upright individual. He has his scruples intact. You know, he is the kind of man I'd want to lead the nation. And you have another side saying, okay, you know what? Rahul Gandhi knows what politics is about, right? He's not a novice. He knows how this game is played. Now, don't you think that he would know that making such a statement would undermine the authority of Dr. Manmohan Singh or the ruling cabinet? So why would he do something like that? Now, Manmohan Singh is not having a third term in office. No one wants that. When we think about leader, he is not the kind of guy we want leading us. We want someone like Narendra Modi, you know, convicted, somebody who is loud, so to say, somebody who would like to follow a leader in that sense of the word. We don't want Manmohan Singh in power. So he is not going to be in power. Now, how do we get Rahul Gandhi to be a viable alternative? How do we turn this anger people might have, this resentment people might have against Manmohan Singh to our favor, to the Congress's favor? Now, I just want a quick show of hands right now. In the Delhi rape case, right, how many people here think that the death penalty should be given to the four accused? Just a quick show of hands. So I see the majority of the people voting in favor of the death penalty. And I'm sure it's because you feel that the death penalty is the worst thing you can possibly do to a human being, and a crime of such depravity deserves a punishment like that. I agree with you. A crime of such depravity deserves the worst punishment possible. I feel that life imprisonment is a worse alternative to the death penalty. Now, I give you a house, and I give you every modern facility and amenity you can possibly want. And the only thing I tell you is that you can't leave. Maybe you wouldn't have even wanted to leave, but the minute I tell you you can't, that is going to be the one thing which consumes you. It's going to be the one thing which defines you. And basically, what you'll want more than anything else in the world is to leave. So when you take away a person's freedom and you put them in jail and you tell them that for the rest of your life, no matter what happens, you are going to be behind bars, that is a revenge and a retribution that is more cold than anything you can imagine. With the death penalty, a year goes by, they're hanged, it's done. So basically, unless people debate, unless people talk to each other, they will not get different viewpoints on the matter. Another thing which I was asked to speak on today is basically this fear people have of public speaking, right? Now, everybody has more or less an idea and an opinion of their own. Even like a rickshawala and an autowala will strike a conversation with you and you will like have a nice conversation with them. But the minute like you take away those few familiar faces, you put a few unfamiliar faces, you switch on the lights, you put a mic in their hands, and they will draw a complete blank. Like, they'll start shaking and things like that. So why does that happen? Right? It can happen because people basically don't have confidence in themselves. They might be afraid of speaking in an allotted period of time. They might be scared about maybe, let's say, their diction, or maybe what they'll actually say when they come up on stage. They may feel that what they have to say is not something which other people want to hear. Again, this is a phobia. Confidence becomes a problem, right? And confidence is a problem which plagues every speaker. Like, maybe if I was more confident right now, I'd walk down to the middle of, you know, where you guys are sitting, I'd make this an interactive session, I'd crack a few more jokes perhaps, but I'm so scared that you won't laugh and I'll look like a complete idiot up here. I'm not going to do that. So again, confidence is a problem which every speaker, regardless of who you are, how long you've been doing this, has to face. And I wish I could tell you that there is a shortcut and there is like a solution which I can give you right now and you'll be great public speakers. But again, with every phobia, solution is the same. You've got to tackle it head on. And you don't have to do it all at once. It starts with cultivating an opinion, an informed decision. We sit on our moral high horses and we talk about how this country isn't going anywhere. How basically we're going to the dogs and how people in parliament are completely leading us astray. I believe that we don't have the right to make comments like that and have an opinion like that unless we ourselves are interested in what's going on. Debate. One thing which I particularly admire about the American system is that when like elections are going on, at the end of it, they get these series of debates from the two presidential candidates. They get them both on a stage and they say, okay, fine, now the entire nation is looking at you, talk to the people. Let them know what you are standing for, let them know what you bring to the table, and let them make an informed decision. We have nothing like that. We have a parliament where people throw chairs, our speaker's voice can barely be heard. You know, somebody tries to speak, somebody comes down and pulls the mic away from their hands, basically. And if I don't know if we're allowed to televise parliament or not, I'm not actually aware of that. But I mean, it's more of a circus than a place where legislators sit and think about the betterment of the nation. Again, as Narendra Modi is so proud of stating, 65% of our population is below 35 years of age. So most of us are basically the people who are going to be in charge of the country tomorrow. If we don't inculcate the habit of actually talking about things, it doesn't matter if you're talking about Game of Thrones or if you're talking about whether Harry Potter is the most successful fantasy novel or is it Lord of the Rings. It could be any simple matter, but when you start talking about things, that is when you start to learn. That is an easy way to get a, to extract a lot from your surroundings, and you don't need to get behind people, you don't need to, you know, lose out in the rat race of life or anything like that. You can manage to do a lot with very little. So when an organization like this holds a session like this, and you get to hear different people talking about different things, when colleges have debate sessions, when you actually go outside your home state and you go and participate in debates, you see different people, you hear how they speak, you hear what they are saying, it all enriches you. And like he was saying, life is not about a bunch of numbers flashing on a screen. Your ICSE marks, your ISC marks, your rank in JEE, all of that is very important, and all of that is almost what every single person right now has. We're all pretty good at what we do. That is why we are where we are. But what separates us? What makes life worth living? What, at the end of the day, when you're looking back, what is going to be that one thing which will make you feel, okay, you know what, this was a life well lived? When we are a nation, a culture, and a race, where we are a race for who looks for quick gratification, right? T20 cricket, social media, you name it. We are in the habit of looking for instant gratification. Now everybody is giving the news. We can get the news everywhere. But now what makes it different? Now when you find like Arnab Goswami shouting at somebody and saying that the nation wants to know, and at the end of it, the nation doesn't get to know anything apart from what the nation wants to know. Anyway, so when that happens, it entertains you. Like I know my dad at night sits there and watches the show mainly because he likes to see Arnab Goswami shouting at people. I mean, we all want to do that. Like, if we can get somebody we don't like, which is the political class of India, you just make them stand here and just shout at them. Make them as uncomfortable as they could possibly be. That is something which will give us a little joy at the end of the day. So, what happens through that is that actual news or the things which actually do matter don't ultimately get across. We want entertainment. We want, like, how else do you explain, like, a moronic movie, like maybe like Dabang or Chennai Express, earning more than 200 crores in beautiful art movies, not getting an audience? We are responsible citizens. We know a lot about what's going on. Maybe among the college people, you'll find people going to the art films as well. But the nation as a whole is not made of just us. There are other people as well, and these media houses cater to them. And these people want entertainment. So although they do have a right to report responsibly, more often than not, we'll find that they don't. And as far as the second question was concerned about the presidential debate in America, like, I'm not aware of what kind of setup we have here. I'm just saying it would be a nice thing, right? Like, Narendra Modi gets up basically when the Prime Minister is away to talk to Barack Obama, and he gets up and he says a bunch of things, right? And then when Manmohan Singh will get back, he basically won't say anything, but then you'll have other people in the Congress saying other things. And you'll have Shashi Tharoor and you'll have Mahesh Jethmalani saying things. And if we could get them on the same platform and let them basically talk to the nation at the same time, counter each other's points at that point, no slander, no defamation, just let's get the nation to know about the things which do matter. I feel that would make sure that this political process is a lot more inclusive and it's a lot more transparent, and that is what the nation does want. So I'd basically like to end with four lines from my favorite poem. The poem's name is Invictus. You might have heard of it. So the lines go, "It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishment the scroll. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul." Thank you very much for listening to me. I thought that this would be a good opportunity to speak about our city's heritage. And Heritage Institute is probably the perfect place to speak about it. I would like to begin with you a story. I used to work for the State Heritage Commission here. I was commissioned for a project to survey the sites around Bengal. So I had to go around and I had to interview people and take pictures and note down the histories of various sites. This offered me a great opportunity to interact with people from the marginal classes, from the villages, and what I found was their interest. There was so much interest in all those sites, and they really wanted something to happen, because not only because of their love for that site for which they are emotionally bond. They have been emotionally bond with their site since their birth. Village doesn't have much to offer, so a particular temple or a particular palace means a lot to them. And so they seriously want something to happen around it. Besides such an opportunity or such a if they can also offered, if it becomes a tourist destination or something of that sort, it will also ensure job opportunities for them, which is a major problem, as you can guess, in Bengal, particularly in the villages. But in this today, due to time constraint, I will just stick to our city. I will present some information about our city, which I feel are lesser known, and I sincerely hope that you will find them interesting. This presentation will have two parts. The first will about tangible heritage, and the second is about intangible heritage. Now, we have a common perception that heritage site or refers to only the historic buildings, and the tangible heritage will or any monument or any statues or any pictures or something like that. Tangible heritage will obviously cover those things, and whereas in UNESCO, we all know UNESCO, the branch of the United Nations, they have a World Heritage Site list, and along with that World Heritage Site list, they have decided to focus on the intangible heritage of the world. Intangible heritage, as the term clearly shows, are those heritage which cannot be touched, which does not have any material existence, yet which are very important part of our life. Such as, it can be a drama, it can be a dance performance, it can be a language which doesn't have any script. Many languages are just living on the edge. They will be extinct within a few years. Here I will confine myself to the forgotten street names of the city. We all know that changing street names is a very common practice with the governments, the various governments that have ruled here. But this street names are very important. Not only they are interesting, but they also offer a very unique way to reconstruct our city's history. Each of these names, I can assure you, have a story to tell. And some of them are indeed like a thriller. So I will begin with the intangible heritage. They offer periscopic view. I believe I am using the word periscopic because, as you know, the periscope is like a winding binocular. But despite of their indirect nature, they offer a very distinct view. The street names also may not be the story they tells us is may not be that apparent, but they are indeed very distinct. And unfortunately, as I have said before, a very few of these old names have survived. We all know that Calcutta was initially comprised of three villages: Sutanuti, Govindapur, and Kolkata. And when the Europeans began to establish colonies in here, the Job Chandak recognized Calcutta as one of the important sites strategically, which can offer them a perfect base for conducting their trading activities. And that's how Calcutta, the city, had its so-called birth. Though the villages are already there. Now, we all know the villages in... If you visit any villages in Bengal, you will find that the villages are divided into small paras. I won't use the word neighborhood because neighborhood doesn't give the sense of a para. I would be more comfortable with the term para. They are more divided into small paras, the villages, and these paras are divided in accordance with the various occupational groups that reside there. This is because of the strict caste system, the occupational class-based system that we have here, and this is a legacy of that. Now, Calcutta was initially a village. You can easily guess that from these names, because some of these names are present in our city as well, even a few years back. Though currently most of them have been changed to pay some quote-unquote tribute to some nationalist leader or some cinema stars maybe, or some musicians, etc. But again, this is a very
this practice again is a strong blow not only to our culture but also to our history. And this has been pointed out again and again by men like Jawaharlal Nehru. He was very much against it. But by Satyajit Ray, he has mentioned it very clearly in his Gorostan Shabdan. I hope most of you have gone through Gorostan Shabdan. In the next slide, I will give you some illustrations of names that bears testimony that this city had its origin in a village. You see some of the names that have survived indeed, such as Kumortuli. Kumortuli was the potter's base. It is still there. The next is Kolutola. Again, Kolutola, the name is still there. Kolutola Street is located near College Street. Kolus were those who extracted oil from the master seed and used to sell people. So in villages, we have Kolutola where the oil sellers used to reside. In Calcutta, we also had a similar Kolutola. Jeletola again, which is self-evident. It's from the name of the fisherman. Dorjipara is in North Calcutta, near Bagh Bazar, in between Bagh Bazar and Shobha Bazar. Jugipara again is where the weavers used to reside. Ahiritola, you know, is one of the most famous pujas in the city. Ahiritola in Farsi refers to the milkmen. So here the milkmen mostly came from North India. They used to reside here. Khalashitola is obviously, as the name says, sellers. I don't know if any of you have visited, Khalashitola is now known for something else. Can you people say for what? It's known for something else now. Okay. Khalashitola is now known for its for the biggest, what shall I say? The biggest, huh? Yeah?
Is it
For
the council?
go ahead.
Like the
biggest government licensed hooch.
So the second biggest red
light. Not the red, yeah. No, it's not a red light, yeah. It has got the second biggest hooch or in what we call, in colloquial terms, Bangla Stur. Muchipara again is self evident as a cobbler's. Kapalitola is interesting, where the Kapaliks or those who used to sell various form of amulets to the village people used to reside. Pikepara is located near the Tala tank, where the security guards used to reside. Now there is another angle, the cosmopolitanism. These names, there are certain other areas, neighborhoods. The names of those neighborhoods showed that how Calcutta, within a space of few decades, became a cosmopolitan city from a very ordinary village. It definitely happened with the coming of the Europeans in India. I hope most of you I hope most of you know that Hooghly was a very hotbed during the late 18th century, because probably it's only in Hooghly where we had four or five major world powers fighting neck on neck with each other for space. We had the British in Calcutta, the French in Chandernagor, the Dutch in Chuchro. The Danish from all the way from Scandinavia in Srirampur, the Portuguese in Bandel, we even had the Greek for a brief period of time in Rishra, and also the Germans in Konnagur. So all these peoples had their, there were the Armenians as well. So all these peoples had their business in and around Calcutta. So it's obvious the various areas in neighborhoods in the city boast testimony to that at some point of time, but now again most of the names have been changed. There is I'll give you some example. The first one is Armani Bazaar, which is not a tribute obviously to Giorgio Armani, it's to the Armenians. Again, the Armenians were once a major power. They were the power behind the throne of the Mughals in the later period, and they were of much help to the British. Parsi Bagan is located near Raja Bazar Science College. China Bazar is located near Esplanade now. We had the old Chinese colony there before they shifted to Tangra. Territi Bazar is interesting. I hope many of you have visited Territi Bazar. It is famous for its Chinese breakfast, which is a very speciality of our city. It was named after a person called Edward Tiretta, who was an Italian who had a market there. that was back in the 18th century. Molonga is an interesting term. It was a colloquial term for the Tibetans. The Tibetans had also had their colonies in the city during the 18th century. Besides, there are a host of street city and the ghats named after Portuguese. They were all over the city at one point of time. Now, another interesting thing, I don't know whether this is you can find this elsewhere in the world or not. The Calcutta also recognized the subalterns, the marginal classes as well in its city names. It's unfortunate that these names have also been changed. It is very unfortunate because these are the men who were the base behind maybe be it the British rule or be it even today. The working class is a major force, major backbone behind any kind of society. And the Calcutta and they have been, and again they have found the recognition in the street names of Calcutta as well. There is an example, Buddhu Ostagar. Ostagar is a tailor. Khan Shama is a cook. Doftori, this is interesting. Doftori is one who binds book. The Doftori Para in Boitokhana, that is near Shialda, is one of the biggest in the world. So there you have the shop, Sharif Doftori Lane. Imam Box is again like a Khan Shama, is a cook. Mathur, again you have a road name of Dr. Mathur, and Rani Mudi, even a owner of a Mudi shop. Next, I'll move on to some interesting. There are some other para or neighborhoods named after has some very interesting origins. Devachan, I've already told you about Hathi Bagan. Yeah, Hathi Bagan was a site where Shiraj kept his elephants when he attacked the city in 1756. Again, to fight against the British. Ultodanga is a name that has again survived, luckily. Ultodanga refers to the Great Cyclone of 1737. It is believed that in terms of casualty, before the tsunami, 1737 was the biggest biggest disaster that the subcontinent faced. We have the Maratha Ditch Lane. So, Devachan was telling you about Borgelo Deshe. Borgelo Deshe, that Lalabi, is about the Borgi attack. Borgis are the Marathi raiders who raided Bengal used to raid Bengal each year in the 1740s, and the citizens of Calcutta decided to dig a ditch along to protect themselves. The ditch was there for about 5-6 decades. Later that was filled up to give birth to what is today the circular road, the lower and the upper circular road, AJC Boston and ABC road today. The fancy lane, it is interesting. Shottarit has mentioned this in Gorostai Shabdan. It is where the gallows of the cities are located, where people used to be hanged, the criminals. Garatola is a very interesting rim, and also Chor Bagan, which were the areas known for theft and burglary. Bharukpara is again a very interesting name. It was also a obvious testimony to the first indigenous circus that we had in India. The circus, so we all know the circus as our industry flourished in Europe, particularly in France and USA in 19th century, and Bengalis also began to invest in finding circa and founded circus companies, and Priyonath Bose was one of them. He was a major figure in the Swadeshi period. Intangible heritage, I will move on to tangible heritage. This is the Tagore Castle. This was built in model of an European Highland castle that you will find in Britain or in Scotland. However, it is located in Pathuriyaghatta in North Calcutta. This was how it originally looked like. But unfortunately, in the 1950s, the property changed hands, and now only the clock tower remains and nothing else. Because the entire structure has totally changed. It is unfortunate that this couldn't be protected. It could have been a major tourist destination in the city. Unfortunately, that is not to be. This is one of the old Parsi temples in the country. The Parsis were first settled in Bombay. The Bombay, again, is still there, a big community, not so much in Calcutta. There are hardly about 100-150 Parsi families here. And this used to be their old fire temple. But I have selected this because this is one of the testimony to the Scottish community that we had in Calcutta. The St. Andrew's Trust. St. Andrew's is the patron god of the Scottish. And so this was the St. Andrew's Church. It's a Scottish church in Calcutta. We also have had a Scottish cemetery, which is in a very poor condition. This is located behind, just beside the writer's building. You can all see that. The Scottish cemetery, I don't have a picture, unfortunately. It is located just behind Shiraj. Shiraj, the famous biryani shop. I thought about including a temple as well. There are so many temples in the city. And most of the old temples are in a very, very poor state. This is located in Taliganj. This is located just beside the Adi Ganga. This is interesting, Bone and Shepherd. This again finds mention, you will find mention in Gorostai Shabdan. Bone and Shepherd is very interesting. Bone and Shepherd is the second oldest photographic studio in the world. In the world, that is. And I feel this is a very, very important site, not only from the point of view of our city, but from the point of view of the world. But unfortunately, again, very little have been done to protect Bone and Shepherd. And it is even more unfortunate that Bone and Shepherd's entire collection, they are the collection which dated back to 1830s. 1837 it was founded. It was founded in Shimla initially. Later, Simon Bone and Charles Shepherd, the founders, moved on to Calcutta. The entire collection was burned down in 1990s. It's very unfortunate that most of the collection is now gone. Only few specimen remains, which were with the universities or museums like Victoria and Albert or others, that all of them are now out of the are not in India at present. Satyajit Ray himself did take a lot of help from the collection of Bone and Shepherd when he did films like Charulata or A Shatranj Ke Khiladi. Simon Bone was one of the major persons who photographed the 1857 revolt. So Bone and Shepherd is another very important site on the city, a very little known site. This is the old mint. The British, after they gained the administrative control of the province of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha, they began to mint coins. This is the second mint that they came up with. This was built around 1810-11. This is a very wonderful site. This is just located in the Strand Road facing the Ganges near Howrah Bridge. And this is built on in the model of the Temple of Minerva in Athens. However, this site was abandoned in the 1950s when the mint moved on to Taratala. And since then, this historic and this architecturally important landmark as well is lying in an abandoned state. This is the old Scottish Church College. This is where it was originally known as the General Assemblies Institution. This is the second oldest college that was founded in Bengal after Hindu College. The entire structure, however, is still standing. It's located near Neemtala Ghat, though it's totally in a shabby condition. In fact, another one interesting point is that the oldest police station, the Jorabagan Thana, used to be located here after Scottish Church College moved to its current location. Again, this is a site that one must. I feel that one must pay some attention. I think that's about it. Yeah, that is it. These are some important things that I could show you. I can assure there is a lot more. There is a lot more if I could have included entire Bengal. But that's it for today. I would like to thank the Devarcharan team again for their warmth, for inviting me and for this wonderful endeavor. I hope this continues for a very long time. Thank you so much. जब तक आपके दिल से आवाज़ नहीं आती ना कुछ करने की, बंदा नहीं करता. लाइफ की हर बंदे मतलब स्ट्रगल किसके लाइफ में नहीं होता, हर बंदे की लाइफ में स्ट्रगल होता है. अगर आप सोचते हो कि आप सबसे ज़्यादा सुखी हो, तब भी आप गलत हो, क्योंकि आपसे भी सुखी बंदे एग्जिस्ट करते हैं. अगर आप सोचते हो कि भैया मेरे से ज़्यादा कोई दुखी नहीं है, तब भी गलत है. आप ध्यान से अपनी सोसाइटी में देखो, अपने आसपास देखो, आपसे भी ज़्यादा दुखी बंदे वहाँ पे रहते हैं, है ना. तब मैं भी मतलब बचपन में कभी लगता ही नहीं था कि जब क्लास 1-3 में पढ़ता था, भैया का ट्रांसपोर्ट का बिजनेस था, अच्छे खासे पैसे कमाते थे, खुल्ले डुल्ले जीते थे, घी मक्खन खाते थे. मतलब फिर यहाँ कलकत्ता में आ गए, फिर यहाँ पे बिजनेस स्टार्ट करने लगे. फिर डैड मेरे सेल्समैन थे, वो पेन और रिफिल्स बेचते थे.
तो क्लास फोर में पढ़ता था मैं, तो लाइक डैड यहाँ कालीबाड़ी में जा रहे थे तो उनका एक्सीडेंट हो गया, तो गिर गए, उनका ये पेल्विक गर्डल होता है वो टूट गया था, तो डॉक्टर्स ने बोला ये तो ऑपरेशन अगर कर देंगे इसका तो मतलब लाइफ मतलब बचना मुश्किल है। तो एक होता है पाँव में रस्सी लटका के ना वेट दे के, तो बोलते हैं कि एक टाइम पीरियड के बाद वो आपस ठीक तरह से अगर कैल्शियम सप्लाई होती है तो वो जुड़ जाती है हड्डी। तो हम लोगों ने ठीक है, तो डैड एक साल तक बेड रिडन रहे, तो सोचा कि चलो ठीक हो जाएंगे, लेकिन एक साल बाद उनको अटैक आ गया, पैरालिसिस हो गया, फिर एक साल तक बेड रिडन रहे वो। फिर उनके बाद अचानक में क्या हो, 15 अगस्त का दिन था, यहाँ गुड्डियाँ उड्डियाँ उड़ाते हैं, तो बस फेस्टिव मूड में था, अचानक में डैड को अटैक सा आ गया, तो उनको हॉस्पिटल ले जाना पड़ा, 2 दिन रहे 3 दिन रहे, 4th दिन पता लगा कि भैया रात को आए नहीं, हॉस्पिटल में थे। तो सुबह मैं गया हॉस्पिटल, पता लगा कि डैड भैया बोलते हैं, भैया रोई जा रहे हैं। अब मैं समझ गया गए डैडी डेथ हो गई। तब उस टाइम पहले तो लगा कि नहीं क्या हो गया, गालियाँ देने लग गया कि भगवान तूने उसे ऐसे किया, छोटा हूँ मैं, पढ़ूंगा कैसे, अब कौन पढ़ाएगा, नहीं पढ़ाएगा, भैया का भी अपना बिजनेस नहीं था। तो फिर अचानक में स्ट्राइक किया, अरे मम्मी का क्या होगा, मम्मी की जिम्मेदारी हमारी है। तो बंदे बोलते हैं ना, पूछते हैं मुझसे कि इतना करेज कैसे आता है, करेज कैसे आप फेस कर लेते हो, जब आपके सामने कोई आपसे, आप जिसको बहुत ज़्यादा प्यार करते हो, मम्मी से कौन नहीं प्यार करता, मम्मी से बड़ा कोई होता ही नहीं है, मेरी मम्मी ही सब कुछ है बस। अब मैंने देखा ये मम्मी का क्या होगा, हमारी ही हालत है, तो उस टाइम एक हिम्मत सी आ गई, हाँ अभी मम्मी को अब संभालना है, तो रोने से नहीं होगा, बहनों को देखना है, मम्मी को संभालना है। तो चलते रहे, फिर भैया भी पंजाब से यहाँ पे आ गए, फिर हमारे लाइफ, भैया ने भी आस्ते आस्ते बिजनेस स्टार्ट कर लिया, सब कुछ ठीक हो गया वापस। अचानक में क्लास 8 में पढ़ते थे, बड़े भैया मेरे मतलब 30-35 ईयर्स की एज थी उनकी, अचानक में क्या हुआ, सुबह 4 भी बोले दर्द हो रहा, मैं स्कूल गया, स्कूल से जब आया तो पता लगा भैया को अटैक आ गया, भैया की डेथ हो गई। अब मैं आया, मेरे को पहले समझ नहीं आया क्या हो रहा है नहीं हो रहा है, भैया की डेथ, हॉस्पिटल में थे सब कोई, तो ऊपर मैं ना नीचे बहुत ही सब रोज हो रहे थे, पता नहीं मैं ऊपर आ गया, मैं बच्चों को लेके, भैया के बच्चे थे, एक 4 साल का था, बेटी 6 साल की थी, मैं उनको लेके ऊपर आ गया, मैं उनके साथ खेल रहा हूँ ऊपर में, अचानक मैं नीचे देखा हल्ला गुल्ला हो रहा है, ऐसे मैंने देखा भैया की डेड बॉडी आ रही है, मम्मी रो रही है, सब रो रहे हैं। अब मैंने इधर मुड़ के देखा बच्चे खेल रहे हैं, तब मैं ट्रेंडम खड़ा होकर बोलने लगा, मैं कह तू टेंशन मत दे, तेरे को जो खिलौने चाहिए मैं लेके दूंगा। मैं उस मोमेंट पे क्या, मैं तो खुद बच्चा था, तब वो टाइम मतलब कलैप्स हो गया, भैया का बिजनेस स्टार्ट हुआ था, बिजनेस अच्छा चल रहा था, 80-90 हज़ार रुपये, पैसे की कभी कमी नहीं थी, मतलब ऐसे था जो मर्जी ऐश थी बोल, अचानक भी वो टाइम आ गया। फिर मैं अचानक भी बोलने लग गया, यार कोई ना, मैं लेके दूंगा तेरे को खिलौने, मैं उससे ज़्यादा सोच भी नहीं सकता था, खिलौने से ज़्यादा बच्चा क्या सोचेगा, मेरे को लगता था बस खिलौने ले दूंगा खुश हो जाएंगे, लेकिन एक लाइफ होती है, एक लड़की की लाइफ, लड़की पढ़ती है उसको पढ़ाना होता है, एक बच्ची है, मैं भी खुद बच्चा हूँ, लेकिन अभी देखें उस टाइम तो मैंने बोल दिया खिलौने लूँगा हो जाएगा, लेकिन एक खास कर लड़की की बहुत ज़िम्मेदारी होती है, बच्ची को पढ़ाते हैं माँ बाप, फिर बड़ा करते हैं, फिर उसके लिए अच्छा सा लड़का खोजते हैं, फिर शादी करते हैं, फिर शादी के बाद भी देखते हैं, उतना कुछ तो सोचा ही नहीं। तो उस टाइम हमारे ट्रक्स जितने भी थे सब उठा लिए गए, जो बंदे मतलब कभी मेरे को गोदी में खिलाते थे, अब ये बात आप बार मत बोलना, ये बहुत सीरियस रीज़न है, गोदी में खिलाते थे जो मतलब उन्होंने गन्स निकाल ली कि कागज़ पत्र दो हमें, मतलब गाड़ी में कागज़ पत्र दो, मतलब पूरा स्टेट ऑफ शॉक में था, DD ट्रांजिशन हो गई थी पूरी, मतलब समझ नहीं आ रहा था क्या हो रहा है नहीं हो रहा है। फिर क्या हुआ, हम एक जगह और दूसरी जगह शिफ्ट हो गए, मेरे भैया भी उस टाइम कॉलेज में थे, मंझले भैया थे, वो बार में काम करने लग गए, और हम लोग एक यहाँ पे एक बार का जो गोडाउन होता है वहाँ पे हमें एक कमरा दे दिया गया था कि उनके मालिक ने कि आप यहाँ पे रह लो, तो हम लोग बहुत थैंकफुल थे उनको कि पहले तो एडजस्ट करने में बहुत अचानक 12 BHK फ्लैट से अचानक में एक गोडाउन के ऊपर आप रह रहे हो, हुआ फिर देखा घर का गुजारा नहीं हो रहा है, भाभी हैं, भाभी के बच्चे हैं, मॉम है, भैया हैं, तो मैं भी काम करने लग गया, मैं टीचर्स को तो अपना भगवान मानता हूँ, मॉम डैड से अपने बच्चों से ज़्यादा प्यार करते थे मुझे मेरे टीचर्स. मेरे को पढ़ाई लिखाई को कोई टेंशन ही नहीं होता अभी. मतलब फेसबुक मैंने क्लास सिक्स के पापा की डेथ के बाद तो फेसबुक देखी नहीं मैंने क्या होती है. अब खुद ब खुद मतलब वही थ्री इडियट्स वाला केस था. जाता था बैठता था पढ़ता था और इस टाइम मेरे को स्कूल से निकाला नहीं जाता था. मेरे को बोलते तू पढ़ना क्या फीस भरेगा. पढ़ मेरे को पढ़ना बहुत अच्छा लगता था. बहुत शौक था पढ़ने का. हमेशा मम्मी को बोलता था मम्मी मैं आपको जयगवार में घुमाऊँगा BMW में घुमाऊँगा मर्सिडीज में घुमाऊँगा. मम्मी को ऐसे बोलता जाता था. बहुत शौक था पढ़ने का. हर आप भी बोलते होंगे हर कोई बोलते हैं मम्मी को जैसे नॉर्मल बोलता मैं थोड़ी ना. तो क्लास नाइन के फाइनल तक मैंने काम किया. फिर जब टेन में आया तो भैया ने बोल भैया मम्मी सजेस्ट करने बोल देख बेटा मतलब जो बात भी मम्मी ने भी बोला था पंजाबी तो ड्राइवर होते ही हैं. तो अभी अगर टेंथ में भी काम करता रहा तो मतलब एक पंजाबी कम्युनिटी में एक और ड्राइवर बढ़ जाएगा. इससे ज़्यादा कोई योगदान नहीं होगा तेरा. मैं प्रोफेशनल भंगड़ा डांसर हूँ. तो मैं गुवाहाटी गया था शो करने माध्यमिक के बाद. तो मैं वहाँ से आया फिर वहाँ से पटना था फिर पटना से बॉम्बे जाना था फिर बॉम्बे से आना था. हमारी बॉम्बे का शो कैंसिल हो गया था मुंबई का. तो पटना से ही हम लोग डायरेक्ट घर आ गए थे. तो मैं घर आया तो अब मम्मी मेरे बाल फैला दी बेटा तू स्टार बन गया अब शोज कर रहा है बॉम्बे आ रहा है. मतलब ऐसे बैठा हुआ हूँ मैं और मैं ऐसे मम्मी ऐसे बैठी हुई है बेड में लेटे हुए मैं उनके नीचे बैठा था और टीवी देख रहा हूँ. बाल खुले हुए थे मेरे. मैं शैम्पू में गया था मम्मी बाल में हाथ फैला रही है बोले अरे भैया तो आज थोड़ा घूमने जा रहा है बाहर चाचा के घर तू तो अब काम करने लग गया है. तो मतलब ज़्यादा काम भी नहीं करना पड़ता जाता है भंगड़ा करता है और पैसे मिल जाते हैं देखो 1,000 1,500 2,000. हंसते 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 अचानक मम्मी खड़े हो गए. मम्मी के यहाँ से ना जोर से एक मशीन चलने की जैसे आवाज़ होती ना वैसे आने लगी. मम्मी बोल रहे मेरे को पकड़ बोल रही मेरे को कहीं ले जा मतलब अजीब सा लग रहा है. मम्मी को नीचे मतलब मम्मी को हम लोग उठा नहीं सक रहे थे. नीचे ले जाते ले टैक्सी में घुसाया बस घुसाया नहीं था टैक्सी में हाथ में मेरे गुजर गए. मतलब मैं तब मैं सच कौन रेडी होता है यार. अब हम बीमार भी सबके मम्मी बीमार होते हैं. मम्मी फिर बोलती है हॉस्पिटल डॉक्टर के पास लेके सब लेके आते हैं. अब मैंने टैक्सी में मम्मी को मैं था भैया था अब ऐसे अंदर गुजारे टैक्सी के अंदर और हाथ में मम्मी को बोले मम्मी उठो उठा रहे उठ ही नहीं रही मम्मी क्या हो गया. आउट हो गया था मतलब जैसे ऐसे लगता था क्या है हो क्या रहे. एक्सट्रीम कंडीशंस में हम लोगों ने भाभी को और बच्चों को पंजाब भेज दिया था माइके उनके. तो नहीं हो रहा था यार 5,000 भैया कमाते थे मैं 500 रुपया महीना कमाता था कहाँ 10 बंदे कलकत्ता शहर में रहेंगे. मतलब इतनी महंगा उनको भेज दिया था वहाँ. फिर मम्मी को ऐसे चढ़ाया मम्मी गुजर गए. एक हफ्ते बाद रिजल्ट आया माध्यमिक का भाई मैंने टॉप किया. अब मेरे को समझ नहीं आ रहा मैं क्या करूँ. जब रिजल्ट आया ना मैं चला गया था मेट्रो में 4 रुपये कटाया. मैं कहा भैया अब नहीं रह सकता यार मैं किसके लिए पढ़ूंगा. मैं जा रहा था मेट्रो में सुसाइड करने स्कूल से निकला. अभी भी सोच रहा हूँ स्कूल के बाद मेरी फोटोज लगा दी थी उन्होंने कि आवर टॉपर्स पता नहीं कितने 92 कुछ नंबर थे ऐसे. तो फोटो लगी देख रहा हूँ मेरे को ना देख के फोटो देख के गुस्सा चढ़ रहा है. मैंने कहा टॉप किया गुस्सा चढ़ रहा है देख देख के तो क्या करूँ. फिर टीचर मिल गए. फिर उस टीचर ने बोला अरे परमिंदर तूने हिस्ट्री में 90 लाया है तो हिस्ट्री हो गई स्कूल में हिस्ट्री में 90 ले आए. उसने वो टीचर मतलब टीचर को ना उस टीचर के ऊपर सबका क्रश होता था. तो उसने मेरे को जफ्फी डाल दी. तो ना मैं खुश हो गया बहुत. सही है एक्चुअली मतलब बता रहा हूँ तो थोड़ा मतलब ज़्यादा फिर भी मैं सीरियस था पूरा. मतलब अभी भी हंस रहा हूँ उस टाइम इतना बहुत सीरियस था मैं. मतलब मैंने सोच रखा था कि आप 2-3 घंटों के लिए मेट्रो बंद करा दूंगा मैं भी. पर क्या हुआ एंड में पता नहीं उसके लिए बहुत हिम्मत चाहिए होती है. मेरे को भैया मिल गया. फिर भैया के साथ मैं वापस भैया ने बोला कहाँ जा रहा है. भैया को मैंने बोल दिया गलती से गर्लफ्रेंड से मिले जा रहा हूँ. भैया ने एक तड़ी मारी मेरे को. मैंने मतलब कुछ बोला था मैंने ऐसे बोल दिया कि गर्लफ्रेंड से मिलने जा रहा हूँ दोस्त के पास जा रहा हूँ. भैया ने टॉप किया तो चल स्कूल में आके रिजल्ट लेके आ मिठाई लेके आते. मैं हमेशा मेरे को एक ही चीज़ पता थी डैड मतलब मॉम डैड हमारी कितनी फिक्र करते हैं. या फील नहीं होता जब वो हमारे पास होते हैं. मतलब डैड को पता है. डैड को जब मरने से पहले डैड को मैं मिलने गया था शंभुनाथ हॉस्पिटल में तब पता है डैड को कि मैं नहीं रहूँगा. मतलब डैड की एक हालत है उनको नाक से पिलाया जा रहा था मुँह से ब्लैक कलर की ब्लीडिंग हो रही थी. मतलब सब कुछ क्लॉट हो गया था सब कुछ. डैड को पता है मैं नहीं रहूँगा. डैड बोल भी नहीं सक रहे थे. भैया पास में खड़े थे मैं आया वहाँ से, मेरे को हिम्मत नहीं होती थी डैड की, ऐसी हालत में मिलने नहीं जाता था, हिम्मत नहीं होती डैड को देखने की। हंसते खेलते मतलब डैड से इंस्पिरेशन का, मतलब तगड़ा लंबा चौड़ा बंदा ऐसे पड़ा देखने का मतलब मन नहीं करता था। तब डैड को मैंने, डैड से भैया ने पूछा कि ये कौन है पहचाना, भैया डैड का ना ब्रेन हैमरेज हो चुका, पहचान नहीं सकते थे। तब भैया ने, मैं खड़ा हुआ ऐसे डैड से पूछ रहे हैं पहचानते हो कौन है, पापा ने सर इतना बोला था, ऐसे दिखाया मेरा, ऐसे दिखाया छोटा बच्चा पढ़ता है, बस ऐसे बोला ना पढ़ता है मेरा छोटा बच्चा, डैड को इतना पता था, इतना बोला है, ऐसे दिखाया पढ़ता है ये, चला गया। उसे दूसरे दिन जब पता लगा डैड नहीं है, मेरे को ना वही चीज़ अभी तक याद है ऐसे, मैंने कहा डैड टेंशन मत लो, आपने बोला पढ़ता, मैं पढ़ता रहूँगा, पढ़ाई नहीं छोड़ूंगा मैं, वो चीज़ नहीं भूलती कभी। कभी पूछता है ना कोई अनफॉरगेटेबल मोमेंट ऑफ योर लाइफ, वही है मेरा अभी भी आपके सामने वो समय। बस मेरे डैड को इतना पता था मैं पढ़ रहा हूँ, ये नहीं आप डैड गए मैं बिगड़ूंगा नहीं डैड के बिना, मैं इधर उधर नशे पत्ते नहीं करूँगा। डैड जो कब जो लगता था कि मेरा बेटा है पढ़ता है, मैं सोच लिया भाई मैं पढ़ूंगा ही।
He's made a very valid point there, as in our country is so obsessed with one-minute judgments. So if you have some issue like say the food security bill, or you're looking at FDI in retail, so it's the FDI in retail then becomes one of two things. If FDI in retail, Walmart is either the next East India company hell-bent on colonizing the whole country and forcing us back to servitude, or Walmart is an organization of Mother Teresa is coming here to help our farmers. As he started off, it's somewhere in between. It's in the gray area. And where exactly is it in the gray area, and how exactly can we realize which parts of it is good and bad, is by rational debate. Not by throwing shoes at each other, not by, you know, blaming people and, you know, cursing them, abusing them, but sitting down together and discussing the merits of the problem at hand. It's very, very important. So, college debates being fun, I think they debates in general have a very well-defined purpose, and I'm glad Shriji brought it out to our attention. Next, I'm going to ask Sarthak Bhaiya from IIMC.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I said good evening.
Good evening.
Yeah. So, first of all, it's a great pleasure to be here because I'm also an engineer. And when I see people standing on the back benches, it reminds me of my engineering days. So, and I also would like to thank Devachan and the Heritage Institute to call me here. So basically, after the last speech of this guy, you know, I was really amazed. It was really awesome. But my story and my speech would be totally a different thing. Like, as I am right now at IIM Calcutta, and people say that it's a big thing, it's a big success and all. So also I have given, I have given the title to this presentation like Journey to Joka. But what I feel that I would like you guys to understand some things what I will tell you during my story, some hardships what I have gone through, and some, you know, some points where I understood the situation and then I took some decisions. So I have given you the, you know, brief of my speech. So I will just start it. Yeah. So as you can see that I have given the title Journey to Joka, because I feel that this is what one thing I have achieved in my life. But the other thing I am going to tell you my story. My story would be more of a learning type instead of my story, emotional story and all. So don't take it as emotional story. Just go through the learnings if you can. So it's just a brief introduction. I belong to a very small village in district Vidisha of Madhya Pradesh. I did my schooling till 8th class there. After that I came to Vidisha. There I have completed my schooling, and then I took admission in engineering college. I got a placement in final year, and then I came to IIM Calcutta. Basically the theme of my presentation would be the three crucible movements. First of all, I would like to define crucible movement. In my perception, the crucible movement is a movement, is a situation where you need to take some harsh decisions and you need to work on that. Whether you get failed or whether you get a success, it's your responsibility. So it can be a make or break situation for you. So I feel there were three crucible moments in last 6 or 7 years in my life, and just because of those moments, some decisions, I am here speaking to you. This was the date, 27th May 2011, just after 3 days of my engineering completion. I was moving towards my home. I was leaving Indore and I met with an accident. In that accident, I lost my right hand, and I was a right-handed person from my birth. So the losing my right hand, losing my working hand was like a end of my first life. That's why I call it end of my first life. But here I just would like to share the incident. I was going in a bus, and just the truck came and hit exactly on that window on which I was sitting. So the next moment when I looked at the floor of the bus, my hand was lying there. So, but as I told you that the worst thing could have ever happened to me, it was the death of my sister. Believe me, that point of time, I was not at all disturbed. My hand was lying there on the floor, but I was, you know, I was just feeling like what has happened. There was nothing like guilt, nothing like regret for this thing. We reached to a village hospital in that bus. I was calling people because, you know, I was stuck in the window and the seat over there. So I was calling people, just come to me and hold my hand and all. But nobody came. I don't know, because of fear or something else. And here, I don't know where I got that, you know, power. I stood up, I hold my left hand, my right hand with my left hand. I came out of the bus and went into the hospital. Then I realized, I asked doctor that, okay, just tell me what is going to happen with this hand. So he told me, don't worry beta, sab kuch theek ho jayega. But I told him that, just let me know, is it going to work or not? So he told me that it is not going to work. When I came back out of the hospital, there was the bus was not there. The driver along with the 65 passengers, they left the place, and it was 12:30 in the night, and it was a very small village. So one of my friends was there with me. He got ambulance from somewhere, and we reached Bhopal at 2:30. For whole 3 hours after my accident, the blood was coming like a flood inside my from my hand. So finally I reached to hospital, and then in hospital I spent 15 days. I left Indore on 27th of May, and it took 14 days for me to complete my journey to Vidisha. I reached Vidisha on 13th of June. But in between these 13 days, I was just thinking like, how should I overcome such things? But one thing always there with me was the positive attitude. The last thing I had overcome at that time, it was the biggest thing in my life. So I just thought, I need to move on. There is nothing that can stop me. And some of the incidents I can tell you, even in the hospital, the 5th day of my accident, I was trying to write Sarthak, my name, on a newspaper with a pen. So then when I started writing Sarthak, so it was not S, it was the mirror image of S. And then I realized, okay boss, it's not right hand, it's my left hand. So, but one hope was always there with me. People were coming to me, beta, what you are going to do, you are a software engineer, coding is very necessary, so how would you work without your left hand? So when I reached my home, there the relatives used to come to me, and there were people who couldn't even stop themselves by saying to my father that don't send this person to anywhere, he's not going to do anything in life because of this thing, he lost his right hand. But these were the things, I always thank those people. These were the things jo wo baatein mujhse kiya karte the, wo baatein mere andar ek aag laga deti thi. I think you are comfortable with Hindi na? So जो भी वो बातें किया करते थे, वो बातें मेरे अंदर एक आग लगा देती थी. At that point of time, got a spark inside me. 27th of May 2011 को मेरा एक्सीडेंट हुआ. Then for 1 or 1.5 month I was at my home. But in between I realized that I need to leave this thing, boss. I can't stay at home because I am going to be destroyed totally here. So one thing, I was sitting at my home, I was alone. So one courier guy came to me and given me something and asked me to sign on that slip. So you can call this thing as ego, but I call it self-respect. When he came to me and asked me to sign on that slip, so it was, you know, fight with myself that I am not going to deny this thing. So I came with that slip inside my room. I worked very hard, you know, just writing Sarthak. It was really hard work for me. I wrote Sarthak, jaise taise maine likha aur slip maine usko pakdai. But that day evening itself, I told my father that I am not going to live in Vidisha. I am going to leave my home. At that point of time, I had a lot of pain in my hand. I had to go to hospitals in every week. But I thought, boss, I am going to leave this place. So my father argued with me why you are going there. At that point of time, I did not even know that how to write. Write is likhna bahut badi baat hai. From morning itself to the night, I used to realize in 240 times at least in 24 hours that I don't have my right hand. So finally, I decided that I am going to leave Vidisha. I reached Indore. I lived with one of my friends, and just for 1 month, I was just doing introspection. I did not know what is going to happen, what I am going to do. I did not know anything. Just वहाँ पर पहुँचा रहता था. I also would like to share one more incident that when I went to purchase that four ruled notebook to write A B C D all the things on my. This is the thing. This incident, you know, left me in the situation where I need to write A B C D all the alphabets on four ruled notebook. A lot of hardship was there. So I just for 1 month, I decided that I am going to start writing. I started writing, and for at least 25 or 30 days, I could not write a whole page in a day. But it was my fight with myself. कि यार बॉस ऐसा कैसे हो सकता है, लिखना तो है ही, वापस से लिखना है. सो आई यूज टू राइट एवरी डे. पेन होता था हाथ में, बट नो प्रॉब्लम, आगे जाना है. देन द फर्स्ट डे आई कुड राइट द फर्स्ट पेज ऑफ एट वन टाइम, इट टुक 1.5 आवर. और उस समय समझ आया कि भाई 1.5 घंटे में अगर एक पेज लिख पा रहे हैं तो आई डोंट नो व्हाट इज गोइंग टू हैपन. बट always one thing, as I told you, positive attitude was always with me there. So I used to write again and again that I am going to reduce the time by 2 minutes. If I am writing today in 1 hour 20 minutes, I will write in 1 hour 15 minutes or something less. So it was always there, and I call this thing self motivation. मुझे बाहर से बताने कोई नहीं आता था. Even उस समय मैं पसंद नहीं करता था लोगों से मिलना, क्योंकि मुझे हर बार लोगों को जवाब देने होते थे, बेटा हाथ खिड़की पर रखा होगा इसीलिए तुम्हारे साथ ऐसा होगा, तुम रात में मस्ती कर रहे होगे इसीलिए तुम्हारे साथ ऐसा होगा. तो आई डिड नॉट लाइक टू मीट पीपल एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम. बट एक खुद का सेल्फ मोटिवेशन होता था, आज 1.5 घंटे में लिखा है, कल 1 घंटा 20 मिनट में लिखूंगा, नेक्स्ट डे 1 घंटे में लिखूंगा. देन द थिंग्स आर गोइंग ऑन. In next 1 month, I decided that okay, I am going to prepare for MBA. I always thank one of my friends, Satish Shukla. He is an MBA from Tata Institute of Social Sciences. He suggested me that okay, Sarthak, you can prepare for MBA. At least there would be something that would engage you. That's why you are not going to have these problems, mental problems at all. So then I started preparing for MBA. It was August when I joined the crash course for MBA. People join coaching for 2 years, the whole course, and I joined the crash course for MBA. So in, you know, लोगों की नजरों में ये एक पागलपन वाला डिसीजन था. लोगों को लगता था यार ये बंदा मेंटल हो चुका है, मतलब ही इज थिंकिंग ऑफ क्रैकिंग कैट इन 2 months. आई हैड माई एग्जाम इन अक्टूबर. I started preparing in August, and I thought, okay, in 2 months, what I am going to do, I don't know. But here is some jargons, but it's not jargon. I have experienced all these things, that's why I am sharing you with all. So when I knew that I don't have that much time with me, so I decided on some things. Like I was an engineer, I have always been good at mathematics. So if you all, I think you all know this thing that there are three parts in CAT: QA, mathematics, verbal, and there is DI and LR. So as I was from Hindi medium till 12th class, so English literally मेरे लिए हमेशा एक प्रॉब्लमेटिक थिंग थी, इवन आज भी होती है. देन QA वाज ऑलवेज माय स्ट्रेंथ. सो दीज टू थिंग्स वर देयर जिनमें मैंने सोचा कि स्ट्रेंथ पे मुझे इतना काम करना है दैट आई एम गोइंग टू गेट, यू नो, आई विल एक्सेल इन दिस थिंग एंड आई विल वर्क ऑन फेलियर्स. लाइक बिकॉज ऑफ दीज थिंग्स आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू फेल इन माय दिस थिंग. एंड थर्ड थिंग वाज द फोकस. I did not lose focus. This was one and only thing: focus and determination. In those two and a half months, one thing I did not do is that I did not lose my focus or determination. I did not go to home. I skipped Diwali first time in my life. I did not go anywhere. Coaching में जाता था, वहाँ से सुन के आता था, लिख नहीं पाता था, घर आके लिखने की कोशिश करता था सारे नोट्स. एवरी डे प्रैक्टिसिंग. एंड यू वॉन्ट बिलीव, आई स्टडीड फॉर 16-17 आवर अ डे जस्ट बिकॉज. और वन मोर थिंग आई वुड लाइक टू शेयर यू, IIMs वर नेवर अ ड्रीम ऑफ माइन, नेवर. पीपल से IIM मेरा ड्रीम है, लाखों लोगों का ड्रीम है, बट इट वॉज नॉट माई ड्रीम. मेरा ड्रीम था एक हैप्पी फैमिली, जो वॉट आई शेयर विथ यू. बट ये एक वजूद की लड़ाई थी मेरे, जब लोग मुझसे कहते थे यार कि तुम कैसे काम करोगे, वो चीज मेरे अंदर एक आग लगा देती थी, मेरे अंदर एक जुनून दे देती थी. एंड फाइनली मेरी फैमिली की तरफ से मुझे हमेशा बहुत सपोर्ट था. मेरे किसी भी डिसीजन में कभी कोई मना नहीं करता था, तुम्हें जहां जाना है वहां जाना है. उनका सिर्फ एक कहना होता था कि यू जस्ट नीड टू बी हैप्पी. मेरे दोस्त, वन फ्रेंड आई यूज टू लिव विथ हिम, ही यूज टू, यू नो, he feeded me like a mother. I did not know how to eat food with left hand. तो रोज खाना बना के रखता था, मुझे खाना खिलाता था, मुझे कपड़े पहनाता था. दिन भर के सारे कामों में जितनी मदद एक माँ करती है बच्चे के लिए, उतनी मदद उसने मेरे लिए की. And also one more thing I mentioned here, self motivation, that I already told you that you need to believe yourself, boss. बिना अपने आप पे बिलीव किए you can't do anything. And finally, I got the result of CAT, and you know, within a week or two, I got 12 IIM interview calls. And you know, it was something like, "Bhai, kahan se kahan pahunch gaye?" And then I realized, okay, if you are doing something with a determination, with a focus, ek junoon hai agar tumhare andar. And this was the point jab pehle baar mera confidence wapas aaya tha mere saath. Jab lagta tha, "Nahi yaar, we have something inside. We are going to do something." And just after 4 months, I got all the results. So, you know, I cracked 17 B school calls, including 11 IIMs. Even saying this thing, it's a big thing for me at that point of time. I never imagined.
कि life का कोई भी exam है ना, उसको professionally लेना चाहिए, emotionally नहीं. मतलब be professional in your life हमेशा, जब आप अपने सपनों के साथ deal कर रहे हो, कोई स्टेप आप उठा रहे हो जो आपके सपने साकार करने वाला है, तो उस चीज़ को इमोशनली से ज़्यादा प्रोफेशन से सोचना चाहिए कि मैंने इसके पीछे इतना टाइम वेस्ट किया है, मुझे आउटकम चाहिए. मतलब इकोनॉमिकली सोचना चाहिए, प्रोफेशनली. जहाँ आपने इमोशनल टच दिया ना अपनी फीलिंग्स को एग्ज़ाम्स के पहले, वहीं आप कोलैप्स कर जाओगे. एक इमोशनल फीलिंग चाहिए कि नहीं मैं कर सकता हूँ, मेरा क्या होगा. लेकिन ओवर इमोशनल हो जाना प्रोफेशनल से ज़्यादा अपने चीज़ से, एग्ज़ाम से इमोशनल हो जाना ना, तब सब चीज़ ख़राब हो जाती है. मैं मेंस का एग्ज़ाम था, उस टाइम ज़्यादा इमोशनल हो गया. एग्ज़ाम से पहले रोने लग गया कि क्या होगा अगर एग्ज़ाम नहीं होगा. उसी फ्लो में आ गया, सब सारा फ्लो टूट गया. बस वो इमोशन में आते आते एग्ज़ाम दिया, कुछ नहीं हुआ उसमें. जबकि आपको सब कुछ आता है, आपने दिन रात प्रैक्टिस की हुई है, जो आपके सम्स आया है उससे बड़े बड़े सम्स किए हुए आपने, नहीं कर सका कुछ. फिर पता नहीं है, ऐसा लगता था फिर क्या हो गया यार. फिर वेस्ट बंगाल ज्वाइंट था 19 तारीख को, फिर मैंने सोचा नहीं ये तो देना है भाई. फिर ज्वाइंट दिया, फिर मेरा टीचर, मैंने ज्वाइंट दे के मैंने बोला सर मैं तो IIT के लिए अब एडवांस के लिए अपीयर भी नहीं कर सकूँगा. तब वो टीचर को ना, टीचर्स को भगवान मानता हूँ मैं बंदों को. वो मतलब उस बंदे ने क्या बोला पता है, उसने बोला यार टेंशन क्यों ले रहा है, मेरी तो तनख्वाह खत्म नहीं हो रही है, तो फिर से पढ़। इंस्टीट्यूट वाले भी बोलते तो फिर से तैयारी कर, हम लोग हैं। मैं ना उस टाइम सोचता था कि मतलब बंदे एग्जिस्ट करते हैं, अच्छे बंदे, मेरे रिश्तेदार को याद आते हैं ना, मैं सोचता था कि नहीं बंदे अच्छे होते ही नहीं है। उन्होंने मेरे को विश्वास दिला दिया कि बंदे अच्छे होते हैं। मैं सोचता था कि ये मेरे पास लास्ट चांस है, लेकिन उसने बोला, इंस्टीट्यूट के डायरेक्टर ने बोला कि तू पढ़, मैं तेरे को पढ़ाऊंगा, मेरे को 1 रुपया नहीं चाहिए, 1.5 लाख रुपये है फीस, मेरे को 1 रुपया नहीं चाहिए। उधर वो विश्वजीत सर बोल रहे हैं कि तू पढ़, मैं तेरे को वही पीजी में रखूंगा, तू पढ़। होते 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 काउंसलिंग स्टार्ट हुई, मैंने पढ़ाई स्टार्ट कर दी थी फिर से, कॉम्प्लेक्स नंबर पढ़ रहा था, मेरे को मतलब अच्छे नहीं लगता था, मतलब फिर से पढ़ना, मतलब अजीब सा फीलिंग आती थी। एक तो डर ऐसे ही लगता था कॉम्प्लेक्स नंबर 3D से, फिर से वही चीज़ें पढ़ रहा था। तो बीच में काउंसलिंग चल रही थी, काउंसलिंग में देखा जादवपुर में होगी, तो टीचर्स ने पूछा कि तू मैकेनिकल करता था, तो प्रोडक्शन है, ये मैकेनिकल है और इसमें मैनेजमेंट भी है। तो मैंने सोचा, मैं कहा नहीं सर, मैंने तो बहुत मेहनत की है, मैं मैकेनिकल ही लेके पढ़ूंगा। फिर मेरे को खुद रियलाइज़ हुआ, फिर मैंने एनालाइज किया, मेरे लिए टाइम बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है, लाइफ का एक एक सेकेंड इंपॉर्टेंट है। अब इस बीच में लाइफ आपको एक अच्छी चीज़ मिल रही है, आप रिस्क नहीं ले सकते, आप कई टाइम ऐसे होते हैं रिस्क नहीं ले सकते। तो मैंने सर को बोला, सर ऐसे काउंसलिंग में नाम आ गया, सर ने बोला हाँ तेरी मर्जी। मैंने उसी टाइम बैग बुक पैक की किताबें को तुम्हें वहीं पर छोड़ी, मैं आ गया, सीधा गया, एडमिशन विशन ली, अभी हम वहाँ पढ़ रहे हैं, बड़ा अच्छा कैंपस है। मज़ा सही में लाइफ ऐसे ही आती रहती है। अब मैं अगर सोचूंगा ऐसे यहाँ पे अभी खड़ा होकर सोचूंगा, भैया मैंने लाइफ में बहुत कुछ देखा। क्लास 12 में मेरे साथ और एक बड़ा शौक हुआ, मेरे स्कूल से मेरे अवार्ड मी माई स्कूल है सेंड अ फाइल to the Telugu School of Arts for Excellence, right? It is conducted every year. So, a file has been sent. मेरे को पता लगा कि फाइल भेजी गई वहाँ, तो मैंने बोला ठीक है। अब Telugu School of Arts वाले 2-3 दिन बाद वो रिपोर्टर्स आ गए मेरे घर, आ रहे हैं, मेरी फोटो वोटो खींच रहे हैं। मैंने बोला हो कह रहा है, मेरी लाइफ के बारे में पूछ रहे हैं, मैं लाइफ बता रहा हूँ, फोटो वोटो खींच रहे हैं, मेरे को अच्छी मतलब स्टार टाइप फीलिंग आ रही है। मैंने बोला हो कह रहे हैं, फिर पूछा कि आप सैटरडे आना साइंस सिटी ऑडिटोरियम में ज़रूर। बोला ठीक है आऊँगा। मेरे स्कूल वालों को भी नहीं पता, घर वालों को भी नहीं, मैंने किसी को बताया भी नहीं। मेरे को लगा ऐसे कोई मामूली पेपर होगा, नया नया कुछ ले रहे हैं, मसाला चाहिए इनको। तो Telugu School of Arts for Excellence था वहाँ पे, मैंने देखा, गया वहाँ पे, देखा इतना बड़ा ऑडिटोरियम और मतलब बंदे भरे हुए हैं, एक से एक बंदा आ रहा है पढ़ने, इंट्रोड्यूस कर रहे हैं, ये IIT IIMC यहाँ वहाँ से बंदे आ रहे हैं। मैं बोला हो क्या रही है, देखा एक से एक बड़े से बड़ा बंदा आ ही जा रहा है, सेलिब्रिटीज आ रहे हैं। फिर वहाँ पे एक ऐसे ही था टेलीग्राफ स्कूल अवार्ड्स फॉर करेज एंड केशवरथी मेमोरियल स्कॉलरशिप, जब उसका फाइनलिस्ट का नाम बताया गया ना, मेरा नाम बोल दिया, परविंदर सिंह। मैं चढ़ा स्टेज में, मतलब तालियाँ, इतनी सारी तालियाँ जिंदगी में कोई सुनी नहीं थी, इतनी तालियाँ बज रही हैं, तालियों ही तालियाँ, पूरे ऑडिटोरियम मतलब चमक रहा है। वहाँ पे खड़ा हूँ, जब मेरे को मेडल पहनाया गया, मैं देख रहा हूँ इधर से, मतलब फोटो वगैरह खींच रहे हैं, मतलब लाइन से खड़े हैं रिपोर्टर, ऐसे ऐसे फ्लैशेस आ रहे हैं, वीडियो बना रहे हैं, ऐसे सामने जो बड़ा होता नहीं है ये वाला कैमरा, वैन वाला कैमरा, वो आ रहा है मेरे मुंह पे, ऐसे ले रहा है, मैं देख रहा हूँ। मेरे को ना उस टाइम वो फीलिंग आ रही थी, पूरा याद आ गया डायलॉग शाहरुख खान का, इतनी शिद्दत से तुम्हें पानी की, वो टाइम जो ही बोलता लाइफ से, अगर मैं अपनी लाइफ अपने टर्म्स एंड कंडीशन में जीता हूँ, मैं किसी की बात से इन्फ्लुएंस नहीं होता, अच्छी बात बोलता है तो मान लेता हूँ। पूरी मेरी लाइफ मेरी टर्म्स एंड कंडीशन में है, मैं अपने मॉम डैड के प्रिंसिपल्स नहीं भूलता, टीचर्स के प्रिंसिपल्स नहीं भूलता। जैसे एक बंदे की लाइफ होनी चाहिए वैसे जीता हूँ, और अपने सपनों से अपने एंजॉयमेंट से कभी कॉम्प्रोमाइज़ नहीं करता।
आई ऑलवेज थिंक दैट व्हाटएवर हैपेंड विद मी आई लर्न समथिंग फ्रॉम देयर, सो दिस वॉज द लर्निंग दैट आई फील। बिफोर दैट आई डिड नॉट हैव समथिंग प्लान बी इन माई लाइफ, I just wanted to go to a job and a happy family, the Bollywood style. I love this thing very much, always love yourself. One thing I would like to say all of you, that apne mummy papa ko pyar karo, apne bhai behan ko pyar karo, obviously girlfriends, boyfriends, sabko pyar karo. But agar zindagi mein sabko in sabko pyar dena chahte ho na, actual pyar dena chahte ho na, to apne aap se pyar karo. मैं देखता हूँ यार लोगों के, आज एक ग्रेड कम आ गई, रूम पे बैठ के गुस्सा आ रहा है, रो रहे हैं, ग्रेड कम आ गई कोई बात, मतलब लाइफ खराब हो गई, ग्रेड नहीं आ पाई है। एक कॉम्पिटिटिव एग्जाम में इस बार एग्जाम नहीं निकल पाया, लाइफ खराब है यार. हाउ मेनी टाइम्स यू विल कर्स योरसेल्फ? अपने आप को इतना क्यों कोसते हो? समझ नहीं आता. हैविंग अ वीकनेस इज नॉट एट ऑल अ बैड थिंग मैन. एवरीबॉडी हैज अ वीकनेस. यू जस्ट नीड टू हैंडल, यू जस्ट नीड टू लर्न हाउ टू हैंडल योर वीकनेस. सो दिस इज यू नो द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट लेसन आई वुड लाइक टू गिव यू, दैट do whatever you want to do but always love yourself. kabhi aise mat bola karo yaar ki main bewakoof hu, main ye nahi kar paunga, main wo nahi kar paunga. I really hate this. I never told myself, whatever failures I had in my life, I never told this. This is a place I respect a lot, not because it's a B school, everybody dreams for it, but I respect this place because this, after coming to this place, I got my confidence back, I got with my life again, I got a lots of respect. This is a person, Major Devender Pal Singh. I think if you have seen him on Facebook, he is very popular on Facebook. Times of India called him as the first Blade Runner of India. So he is the person whom I met after my accident. He was a major in Kargil war and he lost his right leg in that war. But what he did not, you know, stay at home, and he started running in the marathons. With this prosthetic leg, he is running the marathons of 25 to 30 kilometers, and he was the one who has given me inspiration for this thing. So I always thank this person. Success is not final, failure is not fatal, it is the courage to continue that counts. And this line has a lot of meaning. I will not take more than 2 more minutes. As I told you that I write poems. So during my accident, after getting this success, I wrote a poem on my, you know, the whole experience of this thing. It is in Hindi. So I just would like to share this thing. कि क्या लेकर के आया था और क्या कुछ लेकर जा रहा हूँ मैं. क्या लेकर के आया था और क्या कुछ लेकर जा रहा हूँ मैं. देखे कभी ना जो सपने उनको सजा रहा हूँ मैं. रूठी किस्मत थी जो मेरी अब उसको मना रहा हूँ मैं. उठी किस्मत थी जो मेरी अब उसको मना रहा हूँ मैं. जो कुछ छूट गया था मुझसे वापस उसे पा रहा हूँ मैं. पर ऐसा जीवन जीवन ही क्या, पर ऐसा जीवन जीवन ही क्या जिसमें कुछ कठिनाई ना हो. ये तो कुछ ऐसा है जैसे धूप में भी परछाई ना हो. सुख दुख तो एक चक्र है ऐसा जो हर पल चलता जाएगा. सुख दुख तो एक चक्र है ऐसा जो हर पल चलता जाएगा. पर बन इस काबिल के ये दुख भी तुझे डिगा नहीं पाएगा. कुछ खोने का अफसोस नहीं अब, कुछ खोने का अफसोस नहीं अब, ये सबको बतलाऊंगा मैं. पर सीखा जो भी इस दौर में मैंने, औरों को भी सिखलाऊंगा मैं. हम हमेशा ये बोलते हैं यार, मेरा एक्सीडेंट हुआ था, मैं भी ये बोला करता था यार कि 120 करोड़ का हिंदुस्तान है, मेरे साथ ही एक्सीडेंट क्यों हुआ. बट बॉस जब मैं आई एम कलकत्ता आया, मेरे पास इतने सारे कॉल्स थे, मेरे दिमाग में कभी ये बात नहीं आई कि यार लाखों लोग तो एस्पायर कर रहे हैं, मेरे को ये कॉल क्यों मिली. So on this thing, I have written this song. कि दर्द मिले तुमको भी कभी तो ना कहना कि मैं ही क्यों. कि दर्द मिले तुमको भी कभी तो ना कहना कि मैं ही क्यों. फंस जाओ कभी किसी उलझन में तो ना कहना कि मैं ही क्यों. विश्वास रखो इतना खुद पर कि जो भी हूँ बस मैं ही हूँ. विश्वास रखो इतना खुद पर कि जो भी हूँ बस मैं ही हूँ. लड़ता जा हर मुश्किल पल से कि जो भी हूँ बस मैं ही हूँ. फिर जल्द ही एक दिन आएगा तो इतना सब कुछ पाएगा, फिर खुद ही ना कह पाएगा कि अब मैं ही क्यों, अब मैं ही क्यों. थैंक यू वेरी मच.